1798, one of the great leaders of the Hasidic world, Rav Shneur Zalman of Liadi, who was the first Lubavitcher Rebbe, was denounced by religious opponents. He was denounced by the Misnagdim to the government, and he was imprisoned in St. Petersburg. We're told that the prison guards were very enamored with him. They saw on his face he was a very spiritual and holy person. They saw him spending his days meditating and praying and studying. They tell stories that there were tremendous miracles that took place in the prison cell. And one day the head of the guards approaches the Rebbe and says, Rabbi, I see that you're a very holy and spiritual person. I'm wondering if I can ask you a question. The rabbi says, for sure, by all means. And the jailer says, you know, I see that you're studying the Bible a lot and you're studying. You must know a lot about our holy scriptures. And he says, I've been studying the Bible my whole life. And the rabbi said, that's wonderful. And he says, but I don't understand something. Right in the beginning of the Bible, he said, we read the story of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, and God gives them a command that they shouldn't eat from the tree of knowledge of good and evil, and they disobey God, and they're embarrassed by what they do, and they run away and they hide. And the jailer says to the rabbi, and God says to them, where are you? Now the jailer says, God created the entire world. God is omnipotent. God is omniscient. God knows everything. So if God knows everything, why does God have to ask them, where are you? So the Rebbe says to the jailer, that's a very, very great question. And he says, do you believe that the Bible that was given to us was written for all people at all times? And the jailer said, of course, it's got a message for all of us. And the Rebbe said, that's correct. He said, really, when God is asking Adam and Eve, where are you? It's not just Adam and Eve he's asking that question to. God is asking that question to every single human being who will ever live. And God is asking us all, where are you? God is asking us, I've put you in this world for a purpose. You're here to accomplish things in life. And every single day, God calls out to man and says, where are you in your world? Your life is supposed to be a journey. How far along are you on your journey? He said to the jailer, you've lived 46 years now. How far along are you? Now, when the jailer heard the Rebbe nail exactly how old he was, he stood up straight. He put his arm around the Rebbe's shoulder. He said, bravo, Rabbi. But inside his heart trembled because he knew this question that God was asking Adam and Eve, where are you, was also a question for him as well. The truth is that this question that God asked Adam and Eve, Ayeka, Ayeka, where are you, is the first question in the Bible. And as we know, the first time anything happens in the Bible is very, very important. So as the first question in the Bible, what we're learning is that this is supposed to be the primary question. And it's supposed to be the primary question we ask ourselves every day of our lives. Not just waiting to have God ask it, because really when God is asking it, it wells up in our mind, it comes up in our own thoughts. It's a question we should be asking ourselves. It's life's most important question, to ask ourselves, where are we? I believe it was Socrates who said, the unexamined life is not worth living. That if we go through our lives without thinking about our lives and how we're doing and how we're progressing and what we've accomplished, he said, it's not a life worth living. Now, it's true that we understand why this is a very important idea. It's not difficult to understand why it would be important to ask ourselves, where are we? But we become very busy people and very distracted in our lives. We live our lives on automatic pilot, and we rarely stop to think about where are we. We rarely stop to think about how our lives are really going. Or Moshe Chaim Luksato, in his famous work, the Mesillas Yesharim, wrote that this was Pharaoh's strategy in Egypt, that he kept us very busy. He overworked the Jewish people. He exhausted us and drained us so that we wouldn't reflect on our situation there in Egypt. We wouldn't be able to think about our plight and our suffering and maybe begin to plot a way of getting away. And that's the reality that we all face. We all become very busy in our lives and distracted, and we don't bother asking ourselves this very vital question, where are we? The truth is that Judaism begins as a journey. The very first two words in the Jewish story is when God says to Abraham, Lech Lecha, go to yourself, journey to yourself. Life is all about this journey. Judaism is supposed to be a journey. For example, we have this image of Jacob's ladder, this ladder that connects heaven to earth, and we're supposed to be on this ladder. We speak about, the Bible has this expression, and much of our literature speaks about something called the Derech HaChayim, the path of life. We call Jewish law halacha, going. So all of Judaism speaks about this journey and this trip. And the question is, where are we? And one of the great tragedies is that many people practice Judaism but seem to not really get anywhere. There's a famous story where a young rabbinical student boasted to his Rebbe. He said to his Rebbe, Rebbe, I've gone through half of Shas. I've gone through half of the Talmud. And the Rebbe turns to him and said, yes, but has it gone through you? And that's what Mussar is concerned with. Mussar, which is a word which means instruction or correction or sometimes rebuke. But Mussar is basically a technology to ensure that Judaism takes us to where it is supposed to take us. Again, if Judaism is a journey and Judaism has goals, so Mussar is interested in ensuring and making sure that we arrive at those goals, at least we move in that direction. What are the central goals of Judaism? What are the goals? We could say, as one overarching concept, that the goal of Judaism is something we can call in Hebrew shleimut, from the word shalem, which means complete or perfect. And so the goal of our life is to become complete, complete human beings, complete Jews, perfect, to self-actualize, to realize our potential. That is what we might call the ultimate goal of our lives. Now the Ramchal, when we think about this idea that our goal is to become perfect, to complete ourselves, that again assumes that we're not complete now. And Rav Moshe Chaim Lutzato wrote that God was certainly capable of creating people who were complete and perfect. God could have made human beings complete and perfect, the same way he made everything else in the world. After everything else was created, God said he saw that it was good. He creates the trees and he sees that it's good. He creates the animals and he sees that it's good. But God never says, ki tov, that human beings are good. There's no appreciation of the perfection of the human being. So the Ramchal says that God could have certainly created people who were complete and perfect. This would have made sense because since God is perfect, his creation should also be totally perfect. However, in his great wisdom, God decided it would be better to let people complete their own creation. This is a type of tzimtzum, a type of constriction that God engaged in, where he restricted his own perfection by making us less than perfect. Rabbi David Aaron, who now lives in Israel, originally from Toronto, writes about what he calls our perfect imperfection, meaning the fact that we are imperfect is really the perfect state for us, and that human beings should really be called human becomings, because ultimately we are trying to become who we can really be. I often joke with people when they ask me, what is your denomination? I say I'm part of a movement called under constructionism. Now the question is, why would God see that it's important to let us finish the job? Meaning, why didn't God create human beings as a finished product? And our sages really suggest a number of reasons. Number one, the Kabbalists describe something called the Nahama de Chisufa, the bread of shame. that when you get something as a free gift that you didn't work for, you don't value it, it's not really pleasurable. And that really we only have real pleasure and true pleasure when we've worked for something, when we've really engaged in the process of earning it by our own efforts. And that's when we appreciate it. And since God wants us to ultimately appreciate this world and what we can accomplish, by just giving it to us, we wouldn't really fully appreciate it. Secondly, if part of our self-perfection is to resemble God, throughout the Bible we're told to resemble God, to attach ourselves to God, to go in God's ways. So if part of the human perfection is to become more and more and more like God, well, one thing God was a creator. And so God allows us to assume the role of creators. We don't create the world at large, we create this world, this small world called the human being. And that's why in the creation story, I've often mentioned this, that when God creates the human being, God does not say, let there be man. Everything else was created unilaterally by God saying, let there be light, let there be animals, let there be trees. But God does not create human beings with a unilateral statement. God says, let us make man. Not aseh Adam, let us, in the plural, make man. And the Baal Shem Tov explained, who is God speaking to? He said, God is speaking to us. God is basically saying, I cannot create you. All I'm deciding to do is I'm giving you the raw ingredients of a human being. I'm giving you a body and a soul. But what you will become ultimately is a function of what you do with those raw ingredients. And that's why, for example, we're called Adam. We're called Adam. The Bible says because we came from the Adama, we came from the earth. And the Maharal from Prague explains that just like the earth is pure potential, if you have a big field, what is the field going to produce? It depends. If you plow it and you fertilize it and you plant properly and you water the plants and you take care and you maybe prune and you have to do many things to cultivate land properly, it can produce an orchard. But if you don't properly exploit the potential within that field, it might lay barren and nothing will happen. So we're called Adam because we're compared to the Adama. And every human being is basically pure potential. Each one of us can become a masterpiece, but it's our work that will make that masterpiece. So our goal is to achieve self-perfection, completion, shleimut. Now, we speak about shleimut basically in three areas of life. One is our relationship with God, one is our relationship with other human beings, and one is our relationship to ourself. Bein adam l'makom, bein adam l'chaveiro, bein adam l'atzmo. For example, when it comes to our relationship with God, so we know that in the Bible, one of the primary relationship factors, features, is something called bitachon, to have trust in God, to have faith in God, to rely upon God. So the Bible always speaks about that. There are many verses in the book of Psalms and other places in the Bible that speak about the fact that your life will be blessed if you have bitachon, if you have trust. But the question is, well, how do you develop that kind of trust? It's one thing to throw it out there as a platitude or throw it out there as an important thing, a menu item, which the Bible does, but the Bible doesn't seem to have a well-developed and well-articulated program on how do you develop that kind of trust in God? How do you cultivate it? So our MUSSAR program is there to help us achieve that kind of perfection and shleimut in our relationship with God by giving us the tools to actualize all the elements in what it means to have a relationship with God. What does it mean to have love of God? What does it mean to have fear of God or be in awe of God? All of these aspects of our relationship with God are things that the Bible speaks about almost in passing, but there's no specific program to help us really take hold of these ideas and to make them part of ourselves on deeper and deeper levels. Ben Adam l'chaveiro, our relationship with other people. So we know that Hillel, the great sage Hillel, put this at the centerpiece of his definition of the summary of Judaism. When he was asked by someone that was thinking of converting, can you please teach me all of Judaism while I stand on one foot? Hillel said, what annoys you, don't do to someone else. If it really bothers you, don't do it to someone else. And then Hillel goes on to say, and the rest of the Torah is a commentary to this idea. Now go and study it. Really? The rest of the Torah is a commentary to this idea about getting along with other people? You mean the laws of Shabbat and the laws of keeping kosher? Is it really so easy to understand how every part of the Torah is really a commentary to getting along with other people? So where do we see that? And Mussar technology tries to help us understand that. For example, the Talmud says that every human being, unfortunately, engages in lashon hara, evil speech. To some extent, we all violate the prescription against speaking negatively about others or demeaning others. It's something which is a universal affliction. But we know we're not supposed to do it. There's a verse in the Bible that says don't do it. So the question is, how can we improve? How exactly do we improve in this very, very important issue where the Talmud says that, you know what, lashon hara, evil speech, is worse than the three cardinal sins of murder, idolatry, and sexual immorality. It's a terrible crime. And yet all we're told in the Bible is don't do it. Mazel tov, how do you not do it if it's such an alluring, tempting thing that everybody gets tripped up in? So you had a great rabbi like the Chafetz Chaim who dedicated his whole life to teaching people how to conquer and get control over this area of their lives, their speech ethics. The Torah demands, for example, very high levels of personal integrity and absolute honesty. That's a very consistent theme of the Torah, that we're obligated to be perfectly honest in our business dealings, to high levels of personal integrity. But how do we achieve this? It's easier said than done. The Torah urges us not just to do chesed, not just to do acts of loving kindness and to be nice to people. The Torah encourages us to be people who are people of ahavat chesed, that we love doing chesed. Our souls yearn to do chesed. Well, how do you cultivate that? How do we work on developing that kind of inner trait where we become people who desire to do chesed? These are all the areas that Mussar deals with. There's one last field, which is the field of Bein Adam La'atzmo, where I would say possibly this is the specialty of Mussar. Man's relationship with himself. Mussar focuses on trying to understand who we are, understanding the self, understanding our inner lives. For example, what are our deepest aspirations? What are the deepest aspirations of our heart? For example, do we primarily identify with our bodies, our temporal bodies, or do we primarily identify as a spiritual soul? Who are we? And you could argue that for many people, they are primarily identified with their bodies, not so much with their souls. For example, if you asked people, would it bother you if you lost your iPhone? Yeah, people would not just be bothered. I just heard last week that they want to have some kind of a new classification in the, well, I don't know what it's called, the book that classifies mental disorders. They want to have a new classification for people that have severe anxiety if they can't find their cell phone. So imagine if someone was to think about, would it bother me if I lost my cell phone? Probably big time. Would it bother me if I missed going to my Torah class that I'm supposed to be going to? If I missed going to my class, would that bother me? Which would bother me more? And I think that when we think about really what is going on inside of us, am I primarily focused on my body or my soul? These are the kind of issues that Mussar tries to get us to think about. What truly motivates our behaviors? Why do we do what we do? What are our inner blocks? These are all the kind of issues that Mussar seeks to help us understand. For example, in his masterpiece called the Chovos HaLevavos, the Duties of the Heart, Rabbeinu Bachya Ibn Pekuda explains in his very lengthy introduction, he explains ultimately why he hesitated writing this book. And he said to himself, even though, and he goes through in the introduction all the reasons why it was important to write such a book, he then says, but I began questioning myself, who am I? Am I such a great scholar? Do I have the requisite knowledge? Do I know enough? Am I on a high enough level? He began having self-doubts. Maybe I'm really not the person to do this. Maybe I'm not qualified. But then on the very next page, in a moment of honest self-reflection, he says, you know what? The more I thought about it, the more I realized that that was a cop-out. And that's really not why I'm thinking of dropping the project. He said, I came to realize that what's really making me hesitate going ahead with writing this book, and it was a very massive project. You have to imagine, again, he wrote this in the 10th century, 11th century. There were no word processors or computers. You had to write by an oil lamp with a quill. And it's a massive volume. So it's a lot of work. And he said he came to realize that was really the obstacle was just a sense of laziness. He didn't want to go through the pain and the effort of working on a book like this. So what he originally thought was humility, my humility is getting in the way, he realized, no, it wasn't that. It really was inner laziness. There's a verse we say in our prayers in the evening. We say in the evening prayers, in the prayers for the Shema, we say, V'haser ha-satan milfayenu me'acharenu. We ask that God remove the Satan. Remove the Satan from before us and from behind us. What does that mean? The Satan, this adversary that tries to obstruct our spiritual growth. So the Chafetz Chaim explained one way of looking at it. The Satan in front of us, we understand that pretty simply. The Satan, the adversary that stands in front of us, is always the classical tempter or temptress. It's always beckoning us to do the wrong thing. So we understand that. You know, all the things in life that tempt us that we shouldn't be doing, and we understand them quite well, each of us according to our own life situation. But what does it mean, the Satan behind us? So some people try to explain what it means is that you have this force that's behind you, meaning after you've passed the test, there's a force that behind you tries to get you to feel good about it. Oh, look at me. And it's very easy to begin to feel puffed up and maybe even a little bit arrogant about your spiritual successes. Maybe that's what's going on. The Chafetz Chaim said it means something else. He said what it means is that each one of us has obstacles to doing the right thing. That's the Satan that stands in front of us. It wants to block us. But he said the Satan behind us is pushing us not to do the wrong thing. It's pushing us to do the right thing. But you know what? Sometimes we have this inner voice which tries to get us to do too much, too soon, too fast. It's saying, you know what? You have to be a big tzaddik. You've got to get up every morning at 4 o'clock and then pray and then go study Talmud. That there are things that we can be encouraged to do. We can have an inner feeling to take on more than we're ready for. If you find people, for example, that are new to Judaism, either they're converts or they're Balei Tshuva, and they want to do everything. And the truth is that you have to learn to walk before you run. And this spiritual force that's pushing us sometimes not to do the wrong thing, to do good things, but too much and too soon, it sets us up for a failure. And when we fail, we haven't accomplished these noble aspirations, then we begin to feel terrible about ourselves. And then we say, what's the use? And then we get discouraged from doing anything in the first place. So we have these inner forces that work on us. They basically shape our lives. They drive us. They inhibit us. They move us along. And Mussar tries to get us to understand these inner forces that work inside of our lives. Aside from getting to know who we are, one of the major interests of Mussar is refining and perfecting our midos, our character traits. The word midos from midah means measures, a measurement. And the truth is that when it comes to our character traits, we're each given different measurements. For example, they fall along a continuum. So for example, some people are too generous. They just give away everything. They can't say no. And some people are on the exact opposite end of that spectrum. They're too stingy. Or a person could be too humble. Could be too humble. And end up maybe not doing what they should be doing because they say, oh, who am I? Or a person can be on the other extreme, too arrogant. Or a person can be too patient. They're so patient, they will even put up with evil. And they won't raise their voice. Or a person can be too impatient. So when it comes to our personality traits, there are dozens and dozens of parts of our personality. And they're called midot because they fall along a line on a continuum. Each one of us gets a certain amount. We're born in a certain way. There are some people who were just born just very laid back. We see this in children, babies. They're very laid back. And we see other kids, they're totally wired and off the wall. So people have different personality makeups. And we're here to basically calibrate them. The Rambam Maimonides says something about the Shvil HaZahav, the golden mean, meaning that we're all supposed to basically find the center point. Where is it where we are perfectly balanced in our midot, when we've perfected them, where we're not too much to this extreme and not too much to that extreme, but we've reached the center point, we've reached a balance point. The rabbis teach us that the essential reason we're put into this world is to work on these character traits. The Vilna Gaon, for example, in his commentary to the book of Proverbs, writes, the essential purpose of life is to constantly keep on improving one's character traits. Every moment that one is not conquering them, he is wasting his life. That's how important this aspect of our life is. The Hasidic great master Elimelech Lvizhensk wrote, a person is only born in order to keep improving his nature during his entire lifetime. The more one is spiritually perfected, the more they will see they have more work to do. It's a lifetime of work. Let's just briefly mention the history of the Mussar enterprise. The truth is that there's a very long history of Mussar going all the way back really to the Bible. There are parts of the Bible. For example, the book of Proverbs is an example which deals directly with Mussar topics. Then going back to the Talmud, a work like Pirkei Avot, Ethics of the Fathers, deals again with the kind of topics to try and perfect the human being. But then there were writers who focused on it more directly. So I mentioned, for example, 1,000 years ago in 11th century Spain, Rabbi Bachya ibn Pekuda wrote his Chovos HaLevavos, The Duties of the Heart. And he was concerned that most of what he saw in Judaism only focused on the duties of the limbs. What do you do? What do you not do? But he didn't see a well-developed literature in Judaism dealing on our inner world. Love and trust and faith and appreciation and gratitude. So he wrote this book to help people really perfect themselves in terms of their inner life. And then in the 16th century Spain, an anonymous author who wrote Orchot Tzadikim, The Pathways of the Righteous, which again is a work that goes through many, many different midot, character traits, and tries to help people understand how they can grow in these different areas of their personality. And then I mentioned probably the most famous work, the 18th century book by Rav Moshe Chaim Luzzatto, The Mesilat Yesharim, The Pathways of the Just, written in 1740 in Italy. Again, a masterpiece. It's considered to be the Bible of the Mussar world. But the Mussar world did not become a social movement until the 19th century. Until then, it was just disparate works that were written, and certain people felt it was important to study these works. But in the 19th century, Rabbi Yisrael Lipkin of Salant, we call him Yisrael Salanter, he was born in 1810, he began to see serious challenges the Jewish people were facing as a result of social forces that were impinging on Jewry at that time. He saw Jews as being spiritually exhausted through the persecutions of the czars and economic woes and the rising popularity of secular movements within Judaism, social movements. He saw two things that really bothered him. He saw what seemed to be quote-unquote religious Jews, but who were not very spiritual Jews. And then he saw what seemed to be religious Jews who were not very ethical Jews. And he said, this cannot be. And so he dedicated himself to propagating a movement that became known as the Mussar movement to try to help Jews grow spiritually, both ethically and spiritually, our relationship with other human beings, our relationship with God, our relationship with ourselves. And just like Hasidut was a movement of, you could call revival, spiritual revival for Eastern European Jewry in the 18th century, so Mussar became a revival movement for non-Hasidic Jews in the 19th century, mainly Western European Jews and Jews in Lithuania. Rabbi Salanter used his credibility as a great Talmudic scholar to spread his Mussar teachings. First of all, he published and distributed many Mussar works, magazines, booklets, tracts. He did a lot of preaching and lecturing, and he developed disciples to spread his teachings. Now, initially, he was working with the elite. He was working with students in yeshivot, rabbinical students, and great rabbis. But then he started to work with just regular people, even people that were not yet religious. He was actually one of the first people to engage in what we call today Kiruv Rechokim, reaching out to the Jews who would basically begin assimilating. But his main innovation, one of the great things he's known for, was realizing about 70 years before Sigmund Freud developed his theories of the subconscious, Rav Yisrael Salanter discovered the same idea. And he did a tremendous amount of work explaining the need to sink the Torah deeply into our inner selves, to sink the Torah deeply into our subconscious, to bridge the mind and the heart. He felt it was not enough to know something intellectually, because he saw that people can know something intellectually, but it won't change them. And he felt it was important for people to feel that which they knew, not just to know it, but to feel it. The Bible says, for example, in Devarim chapter 4, Deuteronomy 4, the Yadata Hayom, you have to know it to this day, but then Vahashevota Elavecha, you have to bring it into your heart. You've got to bridge this almost unbridgeable gap between our hearts and our minds. And that he saw as the major goal of the work that he was propagating. The need to embed the Torah deeply in ourselves, because these inner obstacles we have are not easy to expose. We'll discuss in a few moments how we actually attack this. They tell a story that someone once came to Rasul Salanter and said that I only have a half hour to study each day. What should I study? I mean, there's a lot of things I can study. I can study the Bible. I can study the Midrash, the Mishnah, the Talmud. What should I study if I only have a half hour of studying a day? And Yisrael Salanter said, study Mussar. If you only have a half hour, study Mussar. He says, because after you study Mussar for a half hour, you'll see that you really have much more time to study other things as well. Now the truth is, when Rabbi Yisrael Salanter began spreading his Mussar movement, it became a very controversial movement, believe it or not. You would think that this would be something that would be universally accepted. However, the great yeshivot opposed the Mussar movement. They felt that there was no need to have a specialized program to deal with these things. They said, look, if we're just studying Talmud all day long, that's all you should need. And they felt that too much of an emphasis on kavanah and inwardness would maybe take away from the priority people have to place upon actually doing the mitzvot themselves. There's always been this tension in Jewish history between the form and the content. And for so many years, the form of Judaism has been the focus, actually doing the mitzvot properly and punctiliously. And the sages in the yeshivot felt that if you would put all this emphasis that the Mussar movement wanted to place on our motivations and our inner life and the kavanah and the content, it would take away possibly from the focus on studying the Torah itself and just keeping the mitzvot loyally. So there was opposition to Yisrael Salanter. The response that he would have given, I think he actually expresses this in some places, would be like this, I believe. You could argue that there's no need for people today to take vitamins or supplements, that ideally you should be getting all your nutrition from your diet. So if you eat enough vegetables and fruits and nuts and seeds and whole grains, whatever you're supposed to be eating, and dark chocolate, obviously, then you don't need to take vitamins or supplements. And that might be true. And there are people who actually say you shouldn't take vitamins and supplements. You shouldn't do it. However, it is known that if we're living in a world where the nutrients are being depleted from the soil because of various things, for example, the poisoning of the soil in many cases, and the use of chemical fertilizers, and many things that affect the quality of the soil and the quality of our environment and the stress levels we're living under, meaning that you could argue that ideally, in a perfect world, we should get all our nutrition from our regular food. However, it's been argued equally, I think, successfully, that if we're not living in an optimal world where the nutrients are not really properly transmitted through the food and our stress levels are depleting our nutrients anyway, then you need to take vitamins and supplements. And that might be the response of the Mussar movement to the critics. The truth is that history won anyway, and the opposition died out pretty quickly, and it became accepted into the mainstream of the Jewish community. What Rabbi Yisrael Salanter did was to obviously initiate a whole movement. His three major disciples, he had three major disciples, but there became three schools of Mussar that followed after Yisrael Salanter. One was by his great student, Rav Simcha Zissel Ziv, who started a yeshiva in Kelm, and he became known as the Alter of Kelm, and he started what's called the Kelm School of Mussar, a very deeply introspective style of Mussar, and his motto was take time, be exact, and unclutter your mind. So it was a very inner kind of Mussar approach. His student, Simcha Zissel Ziv's student, was Rav Nosson Tzvi Finkel of Slabodka, and he started a famous yeshiva in Slabodka, and he emphasized not so much the innerness, but actually how you live as an inspired Jew. And they emphasized in Slabodka something called Gadlut HaAdam, the majesty of man, and for people to live as if they really were created in the image of God. And then there was the third school of Mussar started by Rasul Yoizel Horowitz of Navardak. It was considered the most extreme of the schools. They took an often radical approach to changing behavior. And the teacher of Yosef Yozel said, don't just influence your soul, you have to storm your soul. We know that the Mussar movement, starting in the mid-1800s, basically was decimated in the Holocaust. Most of the yeshivot, or all of them, were destroyed. Many of the great teachers were killed. But then there was a resurgence of Mussar teaching and scholarship after the war. We had great Mussar teachers like Rav Yerucham Levavitz, Rav Eliyahu Dessler, Rav Elia Lopian, Rav Yecheskel Levenstein, Rav Chaim Shmuel Levitz. Especially in Israel, the great yeshivot that were developing in Israel attracted great spiritual teachers who were the teachers of Mussar in those areas. Again, recently passed away Rav Shlomo Wolbe, one of the great proponents of Mussar in our time. And then we've had a more modern Mussar movement outside of the walls of the yeshivot. So for example, when the internet first started in the 1990s, there were individuals who began posting articles and teachings about Mussar that were not being read by people that were in a yeshiva full-time in Israel, but they were being read by the general public. And then you had modern teachers today who were really training and teaching, again, not the elite from the yeshivot, but the entire spectrum of the Jewish world, all across the denominational divide. So, for example, in Israel, Reb Leib Kellerman, who runs very intensive Mussar programs, he comes to North America and runs them monthly in many cities, including Toronto. And Toronto's Alan Marinis, who now lives in Vancouver, probably responsible single-handedly for the revival of Mussar in modern times. He discovered Mussar in his mid-40s. He dedicated himself to studying Mussar, reading everything he could get his hands on, finding living teachers, finally writing about Mussar, his famous book, Climbing Jacob's Ladder, and his second book, Everyday Holiness, really provoked a revolution of people today dedicating themselves to Mussar practice. Let me just conclude by sharing with you, how does Mussar technology accomplish its goals? Meaning, what specifically does Mussar train us to do in order to grow spiritually? The foundation of Mussar practice is Mussar studying, intense studying of Mussar works, of Mussar literature. The Chafetz Chaim, in his very important code of Jewish law called the Mishnah Berurah, says that we have a daily obligation to study Mussar every single day. He says it's the most important thing we can study. It takes precedence over every other subject. So Mussar demands every day we're engaged in Mussar study. You know, there's a tendency people have to think that I don't need to study. I can figure out life on myself, by myself. You know, when you get a product, you buy, for example, a tape recorder or electric toothbrush, no one on the planet reads the instructions. I don't know of anyone in the world that ever read the 300-page instruction manual for their VCR or DVD player, whatever we have today. People figure, that, you know, I'll just use it. I'll figure it out as I go along. And we see this dynamic in the Garden of Eden. We know that God told Adam and Eve, there are two trees in this garden, two special trees. They're all the fruit trees. You can eat whatever you want. But there are two special trees. There's a tree of knowledge of good and evil. God says, don't eat from it. If you do, you're going to die. That's pretty serious. And then there's a tree of life in the middle of the garden, the tree of life. Now, we know that Adam and Eve react exactly the way a three-year-old kid would react if you put them in a room with 5,000 boxes of beautiful toys and gifts, and there was one box, and he said, but don't go into that box. So the child's going to go for that box first. So God says to Adam and Eve, don't eat from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. We know that's exactly what they do. But we know that there was a threat that if you do eat from that tree, you're going to die. There's an obvious thing that it seems they should have done if they wanted to disobey God. Because God said there's a tree of life in that garden. So wouldn't it have made sense for them, before they tasted from the tree of knowledge of good and evil, if you want to do that, and there's a risk of dying, so first, hop a bite from the tree of life, grab a bite of that tree, and then you'll live forever, and then you can do whatever you want, and you can eat the tree of knowledge of good and evil, and you'll be immune to any possible consequences. Wouldn't it have made sense for them to first take a bite out of the tree of life before going for the tree of knowledge of good and evil? Obviously, it would. And one of the lessons I think that we can learn from this story in the beginning of our Bible is that Adam and Eve, again, are all of us. And Adam and Eve are reflecting our tendencies and our syndromes. Because what is the tree of life? What is the Eitz Chaim He? What is the tree of life? It should be right behind me, right? That we call the Torah the Eitz Chaim, the tree of life. So what should they have done? They should have first eaten from the tree of life. They should have first taken the Torah. But what did they decide to do? I don't need instructions. The word Torah means instructions. Torah is God's divine instructions. So they say, we don't need to read the instruction manual. We'll go for the tree of knowledge of good and evil, which means we'll figure it out by ourselves by trial and error. That's what it means, the tree of knowledge of good and evil. We'll see. We'll try it. It'll work. It won't work. We'll make adjustments. But that was their decision, to bypass the tree of life and go right for the tree of knowledge of good and evil, just we'll learn by trial and error. So people have, unfortunately, this inner tendency going all the way back to our Alta Zeda and Bubba, Adam and Eve, that we don't need to study the Torah. We don't need the tree of life. And Mussar says that, no, the primary foundation of a Mussar practice is study, studying of Mussar texts. If you look in front of you, you should have a handout. If you don't have it, just listen, I'll read it for you. But this is from the very beginning of the Mesilat Yesharim, the Pathways of the Righteous by Moshe Chaim Luzzatto. It's one of the most famous introductions to a Jewish book that you'll ever find. And he writes the following, very humbly actually. The writer says, meaning I'm saying this, he says, the author says, I've written this book not to teach men what they do not know, but to remind them of what they already know and is very evident to them. For you will find in most of my words only things which most people know and concerning which they entertain no doubts. He's starting off his book by saying, you're not going to read anything new in this book. It's not a great commercial for your book. Nothing new in here. But to the extent that they are well known and their truths are revealed to all, meaning to the extent that we know these ideas so well, to that extent, so is forgetfulness in relation to them extremely prevalent. Meaning there's a direct proportional relationship between the self-evident nature of these truths and how often we don't think about them, and we basically overlook them. It follows then that the benefit to be obtained from this work is not derived from a single reading. Meaning, don't read this book in order to just get information, because you're not going to learn anything new. But it is possible the reader will find that he has learned little after having read it that he did not know before. Its benefit, though, is to be derived rather through review and persistent study, by which one is reminded of those things which by nature he is prone to forget, and through which he is caused to take to heart the duty that he tends to overlook. I mean, there are many things that I know. I know it. I'll give you a very mundane example. Maybe it's a stupid example, but I thought of this recently. Last spring, I developed a very bad pain in my knees, and I had to go to many doctor appointments, and it became very expensive to take cabs everywhere. So I signed up for elder, what is it, some kind of a program where people over 55 or whatever can get rides. I forget what it's called already. There are a few programs in Toronto like this. And so I knew that I had this option. I knew that instead of calling a cab, I can make a reservation a few days in advance to get picked up by one of these vehicles. And I found often I would just forget to make the reservation and I have to, at the last minute, call a cab. Now, the reality is I knew about this service. I had used it once or twice. It wasn't something that was foreign to me. And yet, because it wasn't something that I was, that was saturated into my brain, it wasn't a service that I was always thinking about, I would often forget it. So Moshe Chaim Luzzatto here is saying there are so many things in life that we know about them, but we just don't think about them. And often we deny them. It's sort of a personal form of denial. I'm not paying attention to those things I know about. And he says the way that Mussar study can help you overcome this internal block of forgetting those things that you really should be paying attention to is by taking a Mussar text and reading it many, 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 many times. So people, for example, might read a book like the Mesilat Yesharim. They might read a chapter, one chapter, every day for 3 or 4 months. They're not learning anything new, but what you're trying to do is pickle yourself. You're trying to saturate yourself. You're trying to make the knowledge so present that it's not in the back recesses of your mind, it's in the front of your mind. It's accessible, it's always there, and it will inform you. Because there are two kinds of knowledge. There are things that we know. I'll give you another example from a contemporary author. So imagine if you worked in a company and someone in your company won the $15 million lottery. So he says, everybody in that office building is going to know that Sam won the lottery. There's not, if you asked anyone 3 days later, did you hear who won the lottery? Yes, Sam won the lottery. Wonderful. A week later, Is everybody in the office still thinking about Sam's $15 million? Maybe people are still thinking about it. 3 weeks later, are people still thinking about Sam's $15 million? 3 months later? Probably not. But if you were to ask them, who won the lottery 4 months ago? Oh, Sam won it. But do you think Sam is thinking about the $15 million 4 months later, or 6 months later, or a year later? Because for Sam, it changed his life. Sam maybe in the past would take two buses and a subway to work. Now he's getting driven to work. Sam maybe in the past didn't have too many friends. Now friends from high school are calling him up. Hey, you remember me? So for the person who that $15 million really affected, it really occupies center stage in their brain. For everybody else in that office building, they may know that Sam won the money, but who cares? They don't think about it. It's not important to them. It's already occupied the worst real estate in their brain you could imagine. And probably in 3 years from now, no one even remembers who Sam was. So Moshe Chaim Lutatso says that study is not just to gain information. It's to take these important ideas and to implant them into ourselves, to pickle ourselves with it, to soak it into ourselves. It's funny because when we study Torah in the morning, the blessing we say is la'asok b'divrei Torah, to engage in the study of Torah. But really what you're trying to do, we're trying to soak in the Torah. We want it to soak us, to become saturated with it. However, the great innovation of Rav Yisrael Salanter, the great innovation when it came to studying, was his realization that it's not enough to just engage the mind when it comes to studying. Because he understood that the human being is just not just a mind. We're a mind, but we have a subconscious realm as well, and a huge emotional side. And Yisrael Salanter understood, again, this is 70 years before Freud, he understood that if you really want to impact people, you've got to have the studying engaging not just their brain, but it has to engage their emotions. It has to engage their subconscious. So how did Rabbi Yisrael Salanter propose that studying will engage us more than on just an intellectual level? He proposed something called learning behitpa'alut, learning with enthusiasm, what they would call learning with lips aflame. And he proposed that when you study, you don't just read, but that you chant, and you chant with a very, very impactful melody, and that you engage the text in an emotional way. And he would urge people not just to read things, but to chant them. So to take a phrase, if you find in a book a phrase, when I read the Mesilat Yesharim, if you see my copy of it, in the first two chapters, I've underlined about 30 places because he had so many gems, so many passages that were so delicious. So Yisrael Salanter would say, take those gems and chant them over and over and over again. Not just read them over and over again, but chant them with a melody and sing them and engage them on a very emotional level. And he felt that singing and chanting with a tune, with a melody, he says that engages our inner being, our emotions, our subconscious. Very interesting. All of you know that if you heard a song enough times when you were 5 or 6 years old, you still know it now, 50 years later. I can sing you the theme songs of television shows from 50 years ago. It's quite scary. Quite scary. Things that I'd rather not even remember, they basically became saturated into my soul. And that's why in the Talmud, by the way, people were recommended, don't just read the Talmud. You're supposed to sing the Talmud with a nigun. So you hear it, for example, on the Passover evening, Ma nishtana halayla hazeh mikol halaylot. It wasn't just read, it was sung, it was chanted. And so it wasn't just, according to Yisrael Salanter, chanted as a mnemonic, as a memory aid. It was chanted as a way of getting it to engage our kishkas, our emotions, our subconscious. To be able to feel the knowledge. To feel the knowledge. Not just to understand it, but to feel it. So it's a repetitive chanting of Mussar texts with emotion and with melody. And he proposed that this be done in a special place that he called a Beit HaMussar. because he thought that people wouldn't feel comfortable or safe doing this in a regular synagogue or a regular house of study. So he proposed that communities build a special place, a retreat center, maybe a small building where people could go and engage in their Mussar work. So for people who take this seriously, if they're not just dilettantes when it comes to personal growth, but they want to really dedicate time each day to doing this, to go to a special building, a special retreat center, where you can do it in a safe and supportive environment, where everyone is there for that purpose. You don't have to feel strange by chanting or singing, because everyone is supporting each other. The study of Mussar texts was not just to study them, but to apply the lessons learned from these texts by transformative practices. This is another element of the Mussar approach, which is, again, not just study, but by actualizing the studying with transformative practices. For example, one of the more popular forms of Mussar practice today, I'll just give you a brief outline, is from a book called Sefer Cheshbon HaNefesh, the book of the internal accounting of the soul. It was written, I think, in the late 1800s. And what it proposes is that you have a program where you work on different midot, different character traits for a specific period of time. So for example, you might have a list of, let's say, 10 or 13 or 15 or 20 personality traits that you want to work on. And you take one of them and you focus on it for a specific period of time. It could be for a month. It could be for 2 months. Rabbi Leib Kellerman in his Mussar Vad here in Toronto and elsewhere, he will work on a personality trait for between 1 to 3 years. That's how much time is needed. And he says that's just the tip of the iceberg. But I remember when my wife was in his Vad and they were doing emunah, faith, they spent at least 3 years on that trait. So in current practice, what people will do is to take a trait such as generosity or gratitude or humility or patience or inner peace or whichever they feel is important. Part of the way you develop your curriculum is by going through a list and seeing which ones speak to you. If you have a problem with being generous, that's what you want to have in your curriculum. If you have a problem with patience, you want to be studying that. There are people we know that they never, ever, ever lose their cool. That might not be a priority for them. So you have to basically pick what are the traits that you will work on. And then what happens in this program is as follows. Number one, you find a key phrase. You find a key phrase that you write down. Maybe you post it on your refrigerator or you put it on your computer. And every day you meditate on that phrase. You may want to chant it for a half hour. You may want to just sing a song about it. You want to look at it frequently. But that phrase becomes the phrase that focuses you on that personality trait, and it keeps you paying attention to it throughout the day. You may want to have your phone send you reminders to think about your key phrase for today. And this phrase becomes a focus for the day. Again, through meditation, through chanting, through reading. And what you want to do is during the course of that day, pay attention to how you engage that midah, that character trait throughout the day. So for example, if you're working on generosity, and you notice during the day you had encounters where you got a chance to exercise generosity or overcome your barriers to not being generous. It could be something as simple as someone that knocks on your door collecting for charity. But there are many other ways in which generosity affects our daily lives. Are we generous in the way we judge people? Are we generous with the way we drive? There are many ways in which we can be generous, not just reaching to our pocket and giving money. So what you were going through during this period of 3 weeks or 4 weeks or whatever it is, so you're going to be paying attention to how you're engaging this character trait during the day. And then at night, you do something called Cheshbon HaNefesh. You think about how you did during the day. You try to recall how you faced your challenges, how you did, where you succeeded, where you failed. And many people engage in this kind of Mussar practice, keep a journal. They do journaling. and they want to keep records of how they're doing over the course of a week or a month or 2 months or a year or 3 years in a particular midah. Often this kind of personal spiritual work is done as part of a group that is supportive, a group where you can have, for example, a partner that you check in with, a partner that you study texts with, a partner that can give you feedback. Often people will have a Mussar mentor called a mashkiach. In Hasidic groups, they call it a mashpia. But it's important to have a guide because it's hard for most people to be objective with themselves. You need an objective person that can give you feedback and guidance when necessary. And a major part of this particular program is, again, studying every day Mussar texts that deal with this particular midah. And when we're studying these texts, there are different things that we can do to gain the most out of them. For example, one of the things that the Mussar teachers speak about is visualizations. That one of the ways that we can implant this information in our minds and our subconscious and our emotions is by visualizing what we're learning, by actually seeing it. It becomes more concrete, it becomes more real. So for example, one of the most famous, my book is falling apart already, one of the most famous books that's been translated into English is called Strive for Truth. It's the Michtav Meliyahu by Eliyahu Dessler. So he has, in one of his chapters, explication of a teaching in the Talmud where the rabbis say the following. The rabbis teach that 1 hour of satisfaction, it's actually a bad translation, it's actually better translated as aroma maybe, that 1 hour of a satisfaction in the world to come, in the next world, is greater than all of the pleasures of life in this world. Think about that. You could read that in the Talmud, that 1 hour of the aroma, the satisfaction in the world to come, is greater than all of the pleasures in this life. So Rabbi Dessler felt it's important to actually break that down to help people visualize what's actually being said so it can have a bigger impact. So he said the following. What is all the life of this world? I propose to reveal here something that I learned from my revered master and teacher, Rabbi Tzvi Hirsch Brody of blessed memory. He explained all the life of this world as follows. We all know that life is a mixed blessing, but during the course of a lifetime, everyone has some measure of joy and happiness. So let us collect those scattered hours and minutes of pleasure and enjoyment for a whole lifetime and concentrate them into 1 minute. We shall have an extremely intense experience of joy in that 1 minute. Now, let us collect all the hours of pleasure experienced by all of a person's friends and acquaintances throughout all of their lifetimes, and imagine that we can concentrate them all into that same minute of that one person's life. The intensity of such an experience must surely be beyond description, but let's go further. And concentrate into that same minute all the happiness and joy experienced by all the people in that city throughout all of their lifetimes. And more still, let us add all the happiness of all the people in all the cities of that country and of every country, that is, all that is pleasant and delightful in the whole world during an entire generation. Let us add it all up, concentrate it into that 1 minute, and give it to one person. But this would still not be all the life of this world. All the life of this world is arrived at only if we add together all the happiness experienced by all generations of men from the beginning of creation until the end of time. If we were to take all of this pleasure, all the good things of this world without any exception whatsoever, and give it all to one person at one time, then we should have achieved a degree of worldly happiness which is surely impossible to exceed. And nevertheless, a satisfaction in the world to come, a taste in the world to come, exceeds it. And what is meant by this brief time of satisfaction? He says literally a cooling of the spirit in the world to come. So my revered father-in-law, Rabbi Nachum Velvel Sif, used to explain that this refers to the lowest possible degree of satisfaction in the world to come imaginable. Something like the satisfaction derived by a poor man who passes by the kitchen of a great house where a banquet is being prepared, and at least he's able to enjoy the aroma of the food. So in the world to come, a person who does not merit participation in the actual spiritual delights of that world, but who is allowed, as it were, to pass by on the outside and to enjoy the aroma of the world to come, this is what the Mishnah refers to as satisfaction in the world to come, some slight satisfaction in that world, though not the delight of the world itself. This represents the smallest possible reward allocated for the smallest mitzvah imaginable. For every mitzvah has some reward in the world to come. And it is this minimal satisfaction in the spiritual world which the rabbis say cannot be equaled by all the accumulated joys and pleasures of this world from its beginning to its end. So this is the kind of writing that the Mussar teachers would engage in to help people break down a concept and be able to see it and concretize it so it has more impact. I'll just share you with one other example. There's a book that was written recently called Battle Plans by Yocheved Rigler and Rebbetzin Tzipora Heller. So they cite in here an example where the Arizal, a famous Kabbalist, was teaching once about the concept of infinity, that the eternal life is an infinite. I remember when I was in ninth grade, our science teacher spoke about the universe being infinite. And I remember I started crying because I was trying to picture going out into outer space and going and going and going. It doesn't end. So the idea of something that just doesn't end drove me crazy. So Rabbi Chaim Vital was his student, and he said that he couldn't understand this concept of infinity. So the Arizal said to him, come with me to Tiberias. Come with me to Tiberias, which was not far from Tzfat where they lived. When they got there, the Arizal led Rav Chaim to the shore of the Kinneret and announced, we're going swimming. Because the Arizal was younger and stronger, he was a better swimmer. After a while, Rav Chaim Vital said, I can't swim any further. His teacher would not let him stop. Yes, you can, he insisted. Come further out. Several exhausted minutes later, Rav Chaim again protested he could go no further. He could hardly keep his head above the water. The Arizal asked his disciple, when you look around, what do you see? His head bobbing up and down in the Kinneret, Rav Chaim answered, all I see is water. Now you have some concept of infinity, the Arizal replied. This is the difference between intellectual grasp and concretely experiencing the concept. So Mussar was interested in having us not just know an idea intellectually, but to see it, to feel it, to experience it. One last piece. One of the most interesting features of Mussar work is something that we call pi'ulot or kabbalot, exercises, that what the Mussar teachers would urge people to do was to take on a concrete action and activity that would anchor the thing that we're learning. Let me share with you a teaching from some of the Hasidic and Mussar masters. A few weeks ago in the synagogue, we read in Parshat Naso two very strange areas of Jewish law. We had the passage in the Bible that speaks about the sota, the woman who's a suspected adulteress, and she has to go through a very horrifying and humiliating trial, ordeal in the temple, where she'd either be exonerated or she'd be convicted of what she's suspected of, but it was a very gruesome, horrible experience. And right after that, the Torah speaks about the Nazir, the person that takes an oath that for a certain period of time, they're not going to drink wine or cut their hair. So the Talmud asks the question, Lama nismecha parshat Nazir la parshat Sota? Why are these two passages contiguous? Why does one follow the other? And the Talmud says, because anyone that sees a Sota in her degradation will swear off wine. That's what the Talmud says, that if a person sees this woman that's going through this ordeal, they're going to say to themselves, you know what? This is horrible. Here is a marriage that's about to end. Here's a marriage that's possibly going to be destroyed. Why? Suspected infidelity. And why do people often get involved in that kind of situation? Too much drinking. So the person is going to see this woman in her degradation, and he's going to swear off wine. So the Baalei Mussar, the Mussar teachers, ask a very simple question. Why does the person have to react by swearing off wine? You would think that the shock of seeing this ordeal in the temple, meaning that this would be a horrible thing to witness. You would think that the shock of seeing this would itself be a shock to a person to maintain purity in their relationships. The person's going to say, I'm going to be much more faithful to my spouse. I'm not even going to look at other people. That the person will go through this shocking experience of seeing a woman who goes through the Sota experience, and that should itself be the kind of wake-up call that will totally change the way they relate to their spouse. So what's this idea that they're going to stop drinking wine? So Menachem Mendel of Vitebsk, one of the great Hasidic masters, says basically the following. That in Ethics of the Fathers, in Pirkei Avot, it says, the person whose wisdom exceeds their actions, their wisdom will dissipate. Meaning that if you're the kind of person that you know much more than you're doing, your wisdom itself will not really last. And he says the problem is this, that whenever in life you go through an experience that shakes you up, let's say, for example, all of us remember 9/11. Everyone was affected by that experience. And everyone probably in the world said, you know what, after that experience of 9/11, my life will never be the same. It's going to be a new ball game for me. How often do we have inspiring experiences? You go through a Yom Kippur, and you say, next year is going to be a new ball game. I'm going to be a new person. And there are so many times in life where you have an inspiring experience, something that really wakes you up, and you say to yourself, I'm going to be a new person. And if you ask people 1 year after 9/11, how did your life really change? Most people would have said, you know what, nothing's really changed. Because the problem is that when you react to some inspiration by making vague resolutions in your mind, just saying, I'm going to be a new person, I'm going to be all different, it's going to be a new ball game, nothing's going to happen. So the Baalei Mussar said, you know what you need to do? You need to actually take some concrete action. You need to do something that makes a vessel for that inspiration. Because if you don't build a vessel for that inspiration, it's going to evaporate. Because what happens is, you're living with this inspiration, you're living with this wake-up that you had in your life, you're living with this message that says, I've got to be a different person, I've got to be a different person. And you know what happens? You don't change at all. So what happens is you begin living with this cognitive dissonance, that I have all this inspiration bombarding me, and I'm looking at myself in the mirror, and I'm the same person. So what happens with that inspiration? You don't want it staring you in the face and bothering you, so you begin to push the inspiration further and further and further and further away, so you don't have to think about it anymore. So the Baalei Mussar, the Mussar master, said, if you get inspired, if you see something that calls out to you, if you have an experience, don't say, I'm going to be a new person after that. Take some concrete action to make at least the beginning of a change, even if it's a small token action. So they say that's why the person who sees the Sota in her degradation, he might do something like swearing off wine. It's not saying, I'm going to be a completely different husband, but at least he's taking something, some step, some action to express and concretize the inspiration. So the Ramban, Rav Moshe of Nachmanides, Moshe ben Nachman, says in his famous letter, it's actually one of the most beautiful Mussar texts you can read. It was actually printed for centuries in prayer books. So in his Igeret, his letter that he wrote to his son, he says, whenever you finish studying some Torah, whenever you get up from learning, If you've been learning Mishnah or Bible or Talmud or Midrash, whatever you're learning, he said, think of some way that you can implement what you've learned, some practical lesson that you can now do on a concrete level in some small way, but put it into action. Don't let the inspiration just evaporate. So one of the things that he recommends as a pe'ulah, as a kabbalah, as an exercise, he says in his letter, accept upon yourself the practice of speaking in a soft voice to all people at all times. He says, never raise your voice. And he felt that this would stop people from getting angry, and it would be a deterrent against arrogance, and it would help people become more humble. But he felt that just the practice of making sure that you always speak in a soft, calm voice would be very important. So much of Mussar practice is built upon these kabbalot, these acceptances of particular practices to ground our Mussar growth. For example, Rabbi Avigdor Miller, one of the great Mussar teachers who lived in Brooklyn until he passed away recently, he put out a list of what he considered to be 10 ways to grow every day. For example, he would say, every day encourage or compliment one person a day. Now, obviously, you know, you're not going to go to hell if you do it to more than one person a day. But he said, make this an acceptance. Say to yourself, every day I will make it a point of complimenting or encouraging at least one person a day. Because if you say I'm going to do it all over the place, you're not going to do it at all. So make it one person. At least do that. And make sure you do it every day. Find some opportunity to compliment someone, a real compliment, a sincere one, or to encourage someone once a day. Or he would say, give a full smile to one person every day. You'll find if you do this, by the way, it's transformative, not just for yourself, but for the people you're smiling to. So if you just greet someone and give them a full, real smile, it's a wonderful thing. He would say, bless some person each day out of their earshot every day. So if you see a mother with her baby in a carriage, just bless this woman that her child should be grow up to become a great person. Or bless, you see a school, bless all the children in this school. But he said, get into the habit of giving people blessings. He said, do some secret act of kindness every day. Do something in your home that no one knows about, you didn't announce, you did some cleanup, you fixed something, but do something that's kind every day that no one knows about. Alan Marinus suggests as an activity, take upon yourself the commitment to make one phone call or personal visit to someone every day. Meaning every day, just say to yourself, I'm going to call one person a day that I haven't spoken to. One person a day that's lonely. Send them an email or visit them. But if you do it every single day, it seems small. What's the big deal? It's 5-10 minutes. But when you do it every day, you build the muscle and you build it into yourself. This is a story from Rabbi Yisrael Salanter's magnum opus called The Or Yisrael. He has a story from the Talmud where a great, great rabbi got impatient with his wife. Apparently what happened was a poor person came to their door, very, very poor family, by the way. The rabbi and his wife, very poor. But a very poor person came to their door on the eve of Rosh Hashanah Eve, asking for some money. And apparently the rabbi, I think, gave a coin to this poor person, and his wife got annoyed with him, and that provoked him to get annoyed back at his wife. He felt upset with her, that she was upset with him. And the Talmud says that he went that night and he slept in a cemetery. Now, you think that that's not the place that you want to be Erev Rosh Hashanah, to be sleeping in a cemetery. And the Talmud goes on to tell a very wild story that he hears these two disembodied spirits that they're talking about what they experienced during the day. I'm not going to go into the whole story. But the question that comes up is, why does he go to sleep in the cemetery? So Rabbi Yisrael Salanter explains that when he got upset with his wife, he found himself wanting, when it came to the midah of being patient and not getting angry. And he saw this as a very big problem. Because of all the midot in the world, anger is one of the ugliest ones. And impatience is one of the ugliest ones. But his problem was, what do I do? It's Erev Rosh Hashanah. I mean, I can't embark upon a long period of Mussar program to get over this problem with my personality. He said to himself, I need a crash course. I need a crash course in this Midah. So the Talmud says in Pirkei Avot that a person should be very, very humble because the end of every person is worms. Meaning that the Talmud says, you know, there were spiritual, I think that, what was his name, the famous Jewish millionaire? He would go into his coffin every night. Who was it? Rothschild, I think. There were people who would do that. There are spiritual traditions where people would meditate on what it would be like to be dead. And they would sit and they think about the fact that, you know, in 100 years from now, I'm going to have a green worm coming out of my eyeball and a blue worm coming out of my nose. And to think about the fact that I'm not going to be here in 100 years or 50 years. I'm going to be decomposed. And people would actually meditate on this. So the Talmud says that a person should never be arrogant because the end of each one of us is to be eaten by worms. So this rabbi said to himself, I need an experience to teach me humility. Because what is it that led me to snap at my wife? What is it that led me to get angry with her and to lose patience with her? It's arrogance. It's a lack of humility. And it's Erev Rosh Hashanah. How am I going to get a crash course in learning about humility? I'm going to go sleep in the cemetery. So this, you know, is not the kind of pi'ulah that you want to engage in routinely. But it's an example from Yisrael Salantri's writings that sometimes Mussar work requires that you actually go through an exercise, a real exercise, to concretize and to experience what you're trying to change in yourself. Usually, thank God, we don't need to engage in crash courses. Usually, we're not facing terrible problems that we have to deal with at the last moment. Hopefully, most of us are able to plan ahead to do some constructive work in a more organized fashion. And with the tools of the Mussar technology, each of us has a very powerful system for personal spiritual growth. I want to wish each of us success in doing this. Thank you all for coming tonight.